S-curve kind of creates innovation curves. And I think we're in a unique situation right now with the S-curve. But, you know, originally what I was talking about was paper. Then the server farms had been produced. Then floppy disks, which were kind of mobile, right? You could take a floppy disk with you and go somewhere. And then CD. But really now, today, we're in a world of cloud. And there's a lot of good, powerful tools. A lot of good tools for us all in industry that we could use to really do work remotely. The mobile revolution is also something that had happened. So the way that I think about it is today, and I'm going to show it like a slew of these tools in a few minutes, but it's really using these two things together creates a really amazing remote working experience for us all. I think another thing that I wanted to talk about is the world really changed kind of in an instant when the coronavirus came out. This is a snapshot from today of like the virus and how it is affecting us all. So having these remote tools is more, learning them is more critical than it ever has been in our day and age. A lot of us are strictly remote workers currently, and having tools that effectively can be used from anywhere is kind of imperative for tech forward looking companies. I wanted to show you this quick screenshot. This is actually a screenshot. When the coronavirus hit, we went completely remote as a company, hundreds of employees within one day. And a lot of the tools that I'm going to walk through are the tools that my company has used. There's a bunch of issues, like how do you stop working, right? Like now that we're all kind of in this new world, how do you deal with the loneliness, right? Because we're all kind of working in isolation a lot of the time in these remote times. What are the right ways to collaborate and communicate? It's kind of a struggle. Distractions from home, of course, are also another struggle. So I'm going to dive into the remote tools now, and I'm going to just go through a slew of these, and I'll talk through the way that I think about them and the way that I use them and the way that the team at DrChrono uses them. So these are tools that our own company has like kind of implemented several of these. Before I do that, I'll just say that some of these tools, be sure to like for whatever industry you're in, make sure you find the tools that are compliant to your industry if it's not for personal use. So when COVID-19 hit, it created a friction point for doctors who wanted to see their patients, but say a patient had COVID. These are some real texts that I got from a provider saying they needed to do remote visits. How do you instantly, like having a brick and mortar medical practice, how do you instantly go from seeing patients in person to figuring out how to scramble when a patient says, hey, I have COVID? How do you just do a phone call? Is that a good enough experience? This is one company called Beam Health. They built a telemedicine solution. And essentially what they're doing is they're doing video visits, just like what we're doing now on this call. So they have like video visits where you can basically see a patient remotely, do care. Patient basically can get what they need from the provider, and prescriptions can be prescribed, you know, with other types of tools on top of these types of tools. Doctors are now being reimbursed also from remote visits. So it's kind of the world before this, it was kind of hard to get paid, but the world really did change because of COVID. It created a remote environment. Medicare is paying out for medical visits that are done remotely now. And that honestly, before COVID, it wasn't as imperative and it wasn't a priority and providers were not doing it as much, but it really kicked off this whole new world that we're in. So one thing that I think is kind of critical to us all, and it sounds so silly, but what web browser do you use, right? In this new world of working remote, I think the kind of Swiss Army knife for us all in doing all of our work is having the best web browser possible. And it sounds silly. A lot of people just use the de facto. So what web browser should you use? There was this really funny survey done a long time ago, but it kind of kicked off a thought process for me. And this was kind of a joke. It said like, people that use specific browsers had higher IQs than other people. And in my mind, I'm like, huh, this is not real. But this was like an example of like, okay, maybe you should be looking at other options in terms of web browsers. So another reason why I use different web browsers, I use a slew of web browsers for different tasks. And I'll explain like the web browsers and which ones are good for what. So here's a list of a lot of different web browsers. Apple, Safari, you probably heard of all of these. Google Chrome, you may not have heard of Google Chrome Canary. You should definitely do a little research on that one. Microsoft Edge, Brave, new browser that just came out, Firefox, Vivaldi, and Opera. All of these browsers, because it's the Swiss Army knife of your, I would say, remote working life, you for sure should be looking at all these browsers and seeing why do they exist? What is their intent? What are they primarily good for? And you know, in my mind, every browser has its like, I would say, best advantage. And for me, you know, one of the looking at Apple Safari, it's built by Apple, designed by Apple, designed to work with the battery, designed to work with the operating system. It is probably the best browser designed for Mac. So just keep that in mind. That's kind of in my head, the way that I think about it. Another one is Google Chrome. What's good about Google Chrome is that the browser is basically the Google search engine. So you can do searches extremely fast, and Google really focuses on that, like that really tight tie-in. Another one is Google Chrome Canary. I would look at that one. What I like about Google Chrome and Google Chrome Canary is if you like Google Chrome, think of Google Chrome Canary as a way to have like a work browser, Google Chrome, and a personal browser open. So you could have two different emails going at the same time. Firefox is great, definitely a great browser out there. I feel like has some great plugins, has really, I would say, stayed the course in terms of being ahead of the market. Microsoft, if you're using a PC, Microsoft Edge is kind of the new guy out there. I definitely want to do more testing on it, but they do have it for Mac. They do have it for iPhone. Vivaldi, I liked it because of the speed and the design. Very, very fun design. Opera's been around a long time as well. Speed is a feature. Notice like if you load in too many plugins, or if you load in even one plugin onto a browser, it may slow it down. So I noticed for your work, try to reduce the amount of plugins to zero or few when using a browser. Because if you load in 30 plugins into your browser, they tend to slow down to a point where it will impede your work. Another critical thing I would say that when you're working with hundreds of people, like we are all at DrChrono at my company, you need to communicate in robust ways when we're all remote. You can't just sit next to somebody side by side and say, hey, I have an idea, I want to show you something. We kind of are starting to implement a lot of different tools now to roll out screen recording. And screen recording is for internal use and also for public use. So our company, we produce a huge amount of video content and produce it and place it onto websites specifically to also scale and train our user base. So we have well over 600 videos on how to use our product. It allows us to communicate with our user base in a broad way to disseminate that information. This is just, you know, one of the tools, but you can see it's pretty powerful. And this one is called Loom, loom.com. I would definitely take a look at loom.com. You'll see how powerful it is in communicating with your internal staff. But these are, I would say, the ones that I've used several times in the past. Cloud app, let's take a look at it. It allows you to record video in a very fast way and disseminate it to somebody. So Loom and Cloud app are very similar. Cloud app focuses more on like your screen and your screen and what you're working on. Loom focuses on like a hybrid of your face and what you're working on your computer. But you can show somebody, hey, I'm working on this thing, I need your help, and you can draw on Cloud app. It's hugely powerful. I'll point and draw an arrow and say, this is the button, what do you think? And then, you know, there's a dialogue that happens back and forth, all virtually, without us even having to hop on like a phone call or a video. ScreenFlow is another one, a great tool designed for Mac specifically to record longer videos. Camtasia does the same thing as ScreenFlow. Final Cut Pro, I would say that's the robust, probably most feature rich of all of these. Movie makers use it. It's probably the most expensive also out of all of these. Not that expensive, sub $400 for it all in, I believe. But, you know, if you want like a full feature rich, like movie industry ready product, that's what Final Cut Pro is. The rest are very lightweight tools that anybody can like download, and the prices vary, not too expensive. Screenshot software. These are three that I use. I think they're all, Cloud app is here again for screenshot, but I think they're well worth downloading and really seriously taking a look at. Napkin is something I use on Mac. Evernote Sketch is something that is on PC and Mac. Again, when you are working remote and you need to effectively communicate, you need those tools to screenshot something, draw on it quickly, and say, hey, this is the idea, this is what we want to do. And then you want to give that to somebody. So for sure, take a look at these if you're working remote. Voting software. This is something that you may or may not use, but from time to time, we use it at our company. This is a real vote that I had asked some of our employees to do. I just was asking them a question saying, hey, who would like dot, dot, dot? And what I like about voting software is sometimes you have a dynamic room and some people don't want to talk and other people do want to talk. So voting in like a group setting can be detrimental to like their true vote. They may just vote because everybody else is voting yes. But when it's a silent vote and you post it on line and they can't even see the results, you see the results, it allows you to say, okay, this is the true way that the team feels. It's good to know that. This is one, multimeter. This is probably one of the only ones I have not used. I have seen other presenters use it and I've always been impressed. You can do real-time voting while you're talking on a screen to a whole like company. You can get real-time Q&A happening with a whole company while you're presenting. I've seen it. It's pretty impressive. I'm going to be looking into this one, but this one looks like it's like very, very promising in terms of like voting and like interactive presentations. Everybody knows about cloud software. Well, maybe you do, maybe you don't, but all of these guys kind of are different in their own way, right? Some of them are HIPAA compliant. Some of them have, they can be used in certain industries and others cannot. So for sure, look into like what is the best solution for you. Every one of these cloud providers offers kind of something different. And I would be well-versed in like what cloud software could work for you. And what this means is just where do you store your documents, right? If you store them on your local computer, that's really bad. Because if you spill some coffee on your computer, and everybody has, they've spilled something at some point on their keyboard. If you do it at the wrong time and you just didn't save anything, having cloud storage is a lifesaver. I use cloud storage, our company uses cloud storage. I can tell you, employees accidentally dropped their laptop. And when they save their data, it really is like it puts their mind at ease. So this is something I would put paramount, honestly, on like must to do, is look into all the options that I have listed here. These are some of the best options out there that you can kind of look into and see which one's a good fit for you and your company. Some of them are, you know, more for personal use. Some of them are more for like heavy corporate use. If you're like a one-shop consultant, you may get away with like one, and then, or if you have like a large org, others have different feature sets that are more rich for like controls and settings there. Another thing is managing passwords. LastPass is a good one. It manages passwords individually and for groups. Okta is a good one. Very designed for like large orgs to manage passwords. Say you have an employee who works for you and then they leave and you gave them access to 40 accounts. In Okta, you can simply just revoke access and it will take that access away. You don't have to go in to change 40 passwords. Then there's 1Pass. I don't use 1Pass. A number of people use 1Pass. It's like I believe a consumer-friendly password manager. Another thing that I would say is imperative is enable two-factor authentication when you can. If an app allows it, do it. And if two-factor authentication means that there's basically two things you have to do to get into an account. Log in with the password and a thumbprint, log in with password and, you know, a text code. Authy is what we use for our product. Authy is a great option. Download Authy and just see if it's an option for you. There are other two-factor products out there, but when you have two-factor auth, it dramatically ups the security level of whatever software you're using. Another thing that I think is kind of critical for us all is when you're working throughout your day, you may want to list like three things out that you want to do that day that are imperative. And I use specific apps to do that. Here are some of the apps that are out today. I really like Microsoft To-Do. It's a free app, so you can download Microsoft To-Do for free. And what I like about it is the UI is very, very sleek design, good designed app, very simple. It's just like, what am I going to do today? And then you can create multiple lists on different things. Like, here's a team that I'm working with. This is the to-do's there. Great app. I highly recommend downloading it for sure. Another one is Trello. Trello uses a Kanban type project management. That's like a visual way to drag something across the screen as it progresses. So say there's multiple states of need to do, working on stage one, working on stage two, working on stage four. It allows you to do like very, very simple visual like project management. I highly recommend Trello. I believe it's free. For sure, download it. I did list out a few others that I've tested. They're good. I think, you know, you have to really like sit down and look at it and say which one works best for me and the way that I work. But having a cloud-based checklist allows you to manage, you know, say you have 50 things to work on. What needs to get done first? You need some tool. And then you could also share those lists with other people. It becomes like hugely valuable to see like how you've been progressing and what tasks you've done. Note-taking. I would say by far two of my favorite apps that everyone should download for just notes, general notes, and for like a lightweight tracking tool is Airtable. So Evernote and Airtable are, I would say, two staples that everyone should for sure look into. If you have a note app that you use, just stick with it. I would say just make sure it's cloud enabled, meaning you can access it in multiple pieces of hardware. So if you're on one PC or one Mac, you should be able to access it on like your iPhone or your Android. If you can't, that's worrisome. So I really like Evernote. I really like Airtable. They really are very powerful note-taking tools to track just notes. I just wanted to do a call out with Apple Pencil. I feel like Apple is progressing on the tablet space light years ahead of everybody else, where you can express information and exchange information virtually very quickly if you have an Apple Pencil and an iPad. There's the Apple Pencil second gen used for like specific types of iPads. And then there's the Apple Pencil first gen, which is used for different types of iPads. But if you're going to work remote and you need to like exchange information with people, having an iPad would be great. Having Apple Pencil is great. Having Evernote and jotting stuff in Evernote and taking, you know, and sending that to somebody is even better, because then you're really disseminating, like getting your idea across. Email, I would say that these are some of the staples out there. And, you know, some of them are more corporate and other ones are less corporate, but this is really a personal preference for you. I would look into all of them. I mean, for sure, like you kind of probably picked what you like, but for sure, see why the other exists, right? Like why does one do this and the other not? You may think a different way, you know, you may like one over the other. I use Gmail, so I figured, let me dive in and learn the Gmail shortcuts. There are a huge amount. We all live in email. Email takes an enormous amount of our time. Spend an hour or two or three or four learning every trick that you possibly can to make your work more effective and efficient. Here's a couple of callouts. Like in Gmail, what I use, I press C and I immediately go into like a composition mode and I can start drafting. If I press A, it replies to all. If I press F, it just auto forwards. It forwards and I can type in who I'm forwarding to. These are like power shortcuts that I use. There's some new apps out there that people have been really recommending. I actually do use FrontApp internally for our company for specific tasks. These are actually shared inboxes. So like Front has a shared inbox. So say someone goes on vacation, someone else can hop into their email and respond to help them if they needed it, if something came in. It's a pretty powerful email management tool. And think of it this way, like you have, 100 people asking you about your product in the last 2 days. But someone goes on vacation, you can just tell someone else to go into that shared inbox. And then magically that new person can just start to do work. I've heard great things about Superhuman as well. I think it's worth looking into all of these tools because we live in email and it's just a part of our lives. What is going to save you the most time? Another tool that I use is Calendly. What I like about Calendly is you just have it accesses your calendar and shares open time slots that you pick on your calendar that people can book. Now, I use Calendly for interviewing. I use Calendly when a customer wants to talk to me. I use Calendly when internal employees want to talk to me for like, we call it office hours. So I'll post office hours and, you know, say it's like from 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. It'll get booked. So people that need to talk to me book on my calendar. And I don't have to have that back and forth exchange that it's a time suck to say, hey, when do you want to meet? So I look at my calendar and I'm like, okay, I have a free time at 4 p.m. Instead, you just send them a link and it brings them here and then they pick the time. It has saved me an enormous amount of time. So remote meetings, this is one, you know, I think we're on GoToWebinar right now, but I just took this screenshot actually from my iPhone on like what lives in my iPhone. These are just a couple. FaceTime, everybody that has an iOS device or a Mac kind of knows what that is. It's Mac specific. Zoom, I believe, is free for over the first 45 minutes. So that's a good lightweight tool. Google Duo, I think that's another new tool that's out there. But again, you know, what works for your company, what's going to work for you. Again, we also have like video visits. We built our own video visits product for our medical professionals on DrChrono. So there's a slew of tools out there. You really just pick the one that works for you. Critical, I would say, is messaging, right? We're all working remotely. What tool is going to allow you to communicate with your team as effectively as possible? And I just keep asking myself that, right? We use Slack as an internal tool to communicate with our internal team. It's hugely powerful. There are, LinkedIn we use for messaging people outside of our company. Say we're hiring somebody. I really like Slack. There's a lot of apps out there that plug into Slack. This is just DrChrono. So this is like messaging your doctor. You know, again, it's all about that back and forth. What tool works for you? We built a medically, HIPAA compliant tool for the providers and the patients to exchange information. I mentioned Slack, but I think don't forget to Google the shortcuts, right? If you're going to live in a tool all day long, you need to know what shortcuts are there. And it's amazing how many people don't know the shortcuts of Slack when they're using Slack all day or they're using another tool all day. You need to spend a little time to say, how do I make the best use of this tool and with my time? Web CRMs. I really like Airtable. I use Airtable. Close.io is another CRM out there for sales. I like it. It's a lightweight sales tool. We've used it internally in DrChrono in the past. And Salesforce. Salesforce is the big guy out there. Their customer relationship management. They're cloud-based. What I like about all of these, they're just all cloud-based, accessible on your iPhone, on your computer. Really, really great tools. This is just an example CRM from Airtable. It's a powerful, I would say, like lightweight databasing tool for notes, databasing tool for like structuring data that you need structuring. One thing that I'd like to bring up is for sure, when you're working remotely and in the office, macros are really, really important. And a macro is basically just a text expanding code. I'll show you an example. This is inside of DrChrono. You tap a button and it expands text. You simply just tap that button and it expands text. What's nice about it is you can build out your macros, and this is in DrChrono, our software, our medical software. You basically can build out macros and say, okay, if I tap this, I can produce a large amount of text that I repeatedly do. And it just saves you time. We designed our macros to work on iPad and iPhone as well as web. A lot of tools are not designed that way. Here's another, here's our macro buttons on iPad. This is one that I recommend for Mac users, but look into macro tools. They allow you to just expand text. This one, this is Text Expander right here. You just type in your your expander, and then if I type B-I-O, it would produce that text anywhere on screen. Say I'm writing an email, you know, it would produce that on like an email or in a note or in a text. One thing that I wanted to bring up was APIs. What an API is any tool you look into, if it has an API, that is really great. So think of, okay, it's a web tool, that's great. I can access it anywhere, that's great. It's on iPhone, that's great. It's on iPad, that's great. It's on Android, that's great. It's on PC, that's great. But if it has an API, it's even better. And what is an API? Like, what is that? It stands for Application Programming Interface. At the end of the day, all it really does is let apps talk to each other to share data. So going back to the beginning when I was talking about there's a lot of insular, like siloed apps, when you have an API, it kind of opens that app up to be working with multiple different apps. It's an API, you know, internet world. I do think our future is going to be driven by APIs. I like the idea of companies when they have like an API philosophy, our software. But I'll show you like, just to jump into like one quick story, I went to the White House to talk about how do we open up data when we need to. This was a great talk. President Obama invited our company, DrChrono, and it had to do with APIs. The medical industry doesn't have, many of the companies in healthcare don't have APIs. So we had this whole conversation, was able to meet President Obama's dogs. It was great when he was in his presidency. Healthcare needs to be open, right? I think every medical record platform should have APIs for developers to be able to exchange data. Not all of them do. These are just some APIs that are out there for healthcare. But in DrChrono, a developer can basically build an app and exchange data within seconds. And this is just an example of someone signing up and getting into the electronic health record. And then they can get in there and just start building. And when they build, here's just one quick example of just something you could layer on top. So this is like a calendar inside of our stuff. A doctor's patient canceled, and another app is going to rebook that appointment. Totally separate app. It's an app that texts patients and says, we're going to refill this appointment. So it basically refills that appointment inside of DrChrono, and then voila. DrChrono didn't build this. It was another partner, like exchanging data between their app and DrChrono. Last thing, I'm just going to end on this. This is just some fun stuff, and then we can get into any Q&A that's left. But I think it's important that when you're remote, your health is kind of critical because we're all remote because of COVID and things have sort of changed. In your home, I recommend you get a whiteboard. Behind in this image is actually Steve Jobs. He had whiteboards everywhere. I think it gets you standing up, you're remote. You're in home, you can get your ideas out quickly. You could take a photo of it and then message that photo to somebody. At DrChrono, we put whiteboards all over the office. They're everywhere. People are writing on them all day long. But that same culture should be in your home. If you can get a whiteboard for your home, wherever you work, it's a great way to just write information down, take a photo of it, and then you have it. Another thing is walking desks. At DrChrono, we have walking desks. Get one for home if you can. And you can work and get your physical activity in. I think it's a great way while you're remote to really take care of yourself. This is a silly one. This is a desk cycle. So say you have a desk at your house and you don't have the space for a big walking desk. You can get something called desk cycle from Amazon. You can put that under your desk and you can pedal and get a nice workout in. Here's another, I'm just trying to get my point across. Here's something else where you can work remotely and effectively having a nice desk. This is another desk from Amazon. Say you want to go sit someplace outside, maybe in your backyard or someplace, but working remote, having a desk like this is also nice. Here's another one from Amazon. If you really want to be remote and you need a laptop and you want to walk around and get your physical activity in, this is a way to enter information and quickly walk wherever you are. And this is one of the last things I'm going to share is iPad and iPad Pro. They are very mobile devices. If you're going to be remote and you need to move about, get one. Apple is really, you know, this is one video from Apple, but really you can do a lot now on iPad with their new iPad OS. It allows you to enter information, view information, learn things very, very quickly. I think typing on glass, if you're going to really like move about the world, learning how to use an iPad is kind of critical for what our future is going to look like. There's a lot in the device. It's a very, very great device. It's becoming more and more powerful every day. With that, I'll end.